All right, I think you're all set.
You really take this dive buddy thing pretty seriously.
Well, call me crazy, but maybe I want you to stick around a little longer. All right, let's get wet.
Hello, and welcome to the treacherous waters of the Bargain Binge podcast. I'm Apex Predator Dylan, and with me as always is...
Hello, I'm Evan. Come join us 47 meters down in the deep blue sea when there's a sharknado that's coming for you.
You took the words right out of my jaws, Evan. And with me as always
is
also...
The Shallows, that's another one. My name's Aaron.
Oh, yeah, you got one, yeah.
Yeah, I got it. No.
did you guys get it? This is a shark movie.
Oh, that's what we were doing? Oh, shit.
Are you just, like, a big Bradley Cooper, Lady Gaga fan, or...
Yes. I stan my Lady Gaga bisexual sleigh queen.
But we are the Bargain Binge podcast... The last bastion of physical media and your wallet. We randomly select a movie from the bargain bin at wherever and report back to you whether or not it's a bargain. We review the movie contained on the disc as well as the bonus features.
Or lack
maybe
thereof.
Not today. Yeah. But so this disc today was pulled by our very own Evan. Let's
yes,
see
sir.
How he did.
Okay. Digging in once again. See what the bargain gods have in store for us.
Oh, that looks like a cheap
something I've never heard of.
Movie Frenzy?
Yeah, it looks like a ripoff of the Shallows.
Yeah, the Shallows. It looks exactly like that. Like it's got a similar looking woman on the cover.
Yeah,
and
she's like the sharks in the water. Okay, I'm good with this.
Yeah, this is definitely a bargain binge.
I'm happy
movie.
About this.
Yes, that's right. Today we are reviewing 2018's Frenzy, also known as Surrounded in the UK.
Fascinating. Frenzy is a pretty forgettable title. I don't know why it just leaves your mind.
Every single day I go, wait, what's the next one, Evan? And he goes, Frenzy. And I go, oh, okay. And then I do it again another couple
5 minutes
of hours later. Yeah. It just does not stick in the mind. Like, all those other things Evan listed off, have some kind of staying power in my head, but even the ones I haven't seen, but not Frenzy.
Yes, we have our first mockbuster on the podcast, which is a big milestone for bargain bin aficionados. It's a classic trope of the Walmart bargain bin. Frenzy 2018, which is a mockbuster of
The Shallows, pretty much.
Yes.
I think it's just exactly The Shallows, because it's, you know, I was gonna say Final Girl, which I guess it is, but typically that's for like a slasher. I mean, it's kind of horror-y, I suppose.
It's vaguely. This is a SyFy original film. That's how it was distributed. So I feel like they often try to keep a horror kind of thing going on. But Evan, you picked it, so you got to read the back for us here.
Yes, with pleasure. All right, so a daredevil group of young friends, including sisters Paige and Lindsay, run a travel vlog together. They decide that in order to boost their viewership, they should go on an illegal snorkeling trip in a beautiful cove. When their plane crash lands into the water instead, the group finds themselves surrounded by fierce, frenzied great white sharks. With an island in the distance, the group must survive the elements and the menacing sharks long enough to swim to shore, but the aggressive sharks are determined to take them out first. That's just straight up not true. I mean, there is an island, but they never attempt to swim to it.
No, not once. Also, she doesn't run it with her sister. It's her sister's thing that she's just kind of been pulled into.
Yes.
They don't co-run the thing.
Yeah, it's like a big element that her sister has never done this stuff before, but she's just trying to, like, appeal more to her, like, more successful sister.
Yeah. Well, in the words of the characters, they're clickbaiting their videos because we are entering new media, folks. Vlogs, blogs, yeah, etc. Instagram, Facebook. This is a movie for all the influencers out there.
Dude, this just screams, I'm a 50-year-old screenwriter and I don't know how the internet works and I wrote a script.
It also screams like 2014. Despite coming out in, like, 2019. Like, there's something about the specific, like, level of new media bullshit that just feels like it's 5 or so years old.
So, this is the part of the show where we generally would talk about the trailers on the disc, unless, of course, we forget about it, as often is the case. But for Frenzy here, we just don't have any trailers. As soon as you pop the disc in, you get generic just image menu with no music or anything, and the only two options are play or chapters, so...
Yeah, it's one of the most bare-bones menus I've just about ever seen.
It's even less than the Los Dos Reyes 4 Polyculus pack.
It is, actually...
Yeah, wow. There's some other similarities between that and this, but we'll get into that. Also on the back of the case here, I just want to mention, something that it advertises is that this film is in aspect ratio 1.7 to 1. We'll get into that later.
Dude, guys, okay, major discovery here. This was made by Echo Bridge Entertainment.
Yes, this was distributed on disc by Echo Bridge Entertainment, which is the first installment in this franchise of our podcast, where we're talking about an Echo Bridge, but they are the preemptive, definitive brand of the bargain bin.
Yes.
Yeah, overpowering even Grindstone Entertainment.
No, this is a classic production company that comes up a lot on Best of the Worst. That's where I'm pretty sure I remember it from.
They're a big distribution company that does little movies, and the mark that you can always look for with their cases, besides their logo that they emblazon on the spine of anything, is I'm just pulling out the actual art from the disc case, but they print it on this really weird paper that's like way thicker than you'd expect, and the art on it is always so low res that you can see like artifacting all over it. They're the ones, yeah, responsible for the Blu-ray release of Godzilla vs. Biollante, and so we can blame them for the scarcity of that movie, I suppose.
Fuck. Okay, they're on my public enemy number one, man. Like, fuck them.
So let's get into the movie then, I guess. There's it's just insane that we don't have anything to lead us into it. We just gotta jump right in. Usually we can, just talk like, for a little bit.
You just gotta jump in the water. No matter if there's sharks in there, you just gotta do it.
We are introduced to our gang of vloggers who lead a YouTube channel called The Lit Life.
Okay. Hilarious. Because
me and Evan did not hear it.
Yeah, we didn't. We missed it when they first said it, and we heard it at the very end.
Don't know if they say it before the very end, because that's the only time I caught it. And it's during this dramatic scene.
Okay,
it's so funny.
Yes, as we'll get into. But yeah, I thought we just missed it, but if you didn't hear it anyway, then maybe they just don't mention it.
I don't know. The thing about this movie is it just kind of washes over you, much like the oceans of the world.
You mean the waters of a pool? Of your local swimming pool.
To open the movie, we're first introduced to our gang of lovable vloggers who all are extremely stock characters that you would see in any movie along these lines, but especially horror movies. Not really survival movies, which is what this is, which kind of... But you got to fill out that 85 minutes that you got to fill for a sci-fi channel, I suppose. We have Lindsay, who is our main character, her sister Paige, as well as Kaya, their friend, who's
like
a
military
woman.
Veteran.
She's a military veteran, and then we have Evan, who is the dweeb with the camera, and I really just can't think of anyone that can relate to that or anything.
No.
Like a tool walking around with a DSLR.
Like, that, absolutely unbearable, unloved.
I knew this was coming.
And also unrelatable to the three of us is Seb, the jock, sexy boyfriend of Lindsay.
Have you guys ever heard of the name... It's with an S.
It's Sep. Sebastian.
That's what I...
For Sebastian.
Well, that's what I thought, but I've never heard anyone do that. Yeah.
His name is Sebastian, and he is coincidentally under the sea points in this movie. So.
Well, because I thought they kept saying Zeb, like with the Z.
Yeah.
But
no, we got Seb. Lindsay, yeah. Paige, Kaya, Seb, and Evan are our team of vloggers. Don't get too used to them. They will not be with us for much longer. So they are all on an island. This was shot in Thailand, I believe, and they're prepping up for their illegal flight to a no-go zone where you just can't dive, probably because, I don't know, fucking sharks.
It's like a wildlife sanctuary.
Yeah. So. And they find this is going to be a very good idea to put on YouTube. And I mean, favorite of the show, Joe Leoli from Custom Grow 420.
Yeah, what up, YouTube? What up?
He got slapped with trespassing just for filming a video on some railroad tracks. So I can't even imagine what kind of trouble they're looking to get into.
Yeah, it's... I was amused by the blocking in the first scene because it's just them like rummaging around their baggage getting ready to take off on a plane. But they do that for like 10 minutes. It's like they keep walking back and forth to like look at different bags while they're talking to each other.
Yeah, generally you want to have some sort of action going on to introduce your characters, but in this case it's just them rummaging and like literally just saying to each other what their dynamic is.
Yeah, it's like, what are you do? Didn't you pack, or like, what's going on?
Yeah, them trying to line up into that four shot is like hilarious because they just awkwardly stumble into it looking at nothing to try to create some sense that they're doing something, but it's so unnatural, and they stand up and look ahead and so we can get a great shot of all of the heroes we're gonna spend the rest of the movie with.
Oh, well, I guess it shouldn't go without mentioning, before this there is a cold open that is very ominous and spooky, where Lindsay is recording a video on the waters where there's no way she's gonna wind up there in this shark movie, and she's like,
this is Lindsay, Lindsay Lewis, my sister and our friends, they're all, if you find this, could you please give it to my family and tell them?
And it's the worst, like, glitch effect I've ever seen applied to anything to make it look like a video that's, you know, freaking out a little bit. But that leads us into them standing on an island, which is introduced by what you think is a voiceover, but it turns out it's just someone talking.
As the young woman stares into the horizon, she yearns for adventures yet to be had, worlds to behold, and dreams to fulfill. She wonders to herself, what remarkable journey awaits with her incredibly beautiful, remarkably bold, and fantastically intelligent older sister at the... Cut!
So we have Lindsay, Paige, their sisters. But are they friends? Doesn't seem like it. There's some sort of weird tension going on. Paige has decided to recruit Lindsay onto this scuba diving trip into illegal waters, despite her never having done a dive before, never really like being a vlogger before. But at the same time, she has more clout for their YouTube audience. And that's why they're exploiting her. And I just have to know, like, what kind of side hustle she has going on.
So this goes back to the line where they say that they were using her and this other guy as clickbait. And I think it's just because she's dating or one of the other guys in the vlogging group. So it's like,
okay.
You know, it's like YouTube, like, like people like the fact that they're like a cute couple on YouTube, so I guess that's it. And then you learn like later on in the film that they try to orchestrate a fake breakup to generate views.
Like I thought maybe part of the idea is that like they, I don't know, maybe they're like weird, you know, like Instagram life goals people. But that's like as much as I could think of. But the movie makes no attempt to, probably because the movie uses its buzzwords for technology and social media without having any understanding of what they mean.
Yeah, I know if I'm flipping through the channels at 2 a.m. and I hit the SyFy channel and I hear the word vlog, my ears perk up and I'm locked in until 5 a.m. watching this movie.
Yeah.
Lindsay is dating Sebastian, and there's some sort of tension going on between these three romantically, but not too fleshed out in this scene. And we have Evan, who talks to Sebastian, and he makes a coy, like, sort of remark about having sex, and he does his own version of, like, the making a hole with one hand and using your index finger to, like, simulate penetration.
You pumped? You, ready to make this happen?
Hey, knock it off, all right?
But it seems like this man has never seen that gesture be done or know what sex is, because instead he does a gesture with his index and thumb around his ring finger, so it looks like he's putting on a ring, but he clearly means sex.
I don't know what it is with guys named Evan and being sexless.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, wearing patterned button-up shirts and being sexless. Weird.
Being the most intolerable member of a group.
What catches me about this is, like, these people are obsessed with Lindsay and Seb's sex life. And it comes up, like, later in the movie where they just barge into a room that they're in, like, laying on a bed, and, like, Evan's like,
damn, smells like sex in here.
Which is just a horrifying work relationship to be having, and, I mean, yeah. I guess it's not anywhere close to as bad as, like, influencer houses in real life, but
I can only imagine this is tame in comparison to those.
Yeah, it kind of made me think about The Room when that weird guy, like, continuously watches them have sex. Watches
Tommy Wiseau.
Yes. watching Tommy Wiseau shove his penis in women's navels.
Danny, do you have something else to do?
I just like to watch you guys.
Oh, Danny boy.
Danny, two's great, but three's a crowd.
Yeah, so Evan is a weird sex creep. But I guess they all kind of are. Kaya doesn't really do much. They just kind of squabble, talk about, it's like the things that we underline, that's pretty much just like 10 minutes of the movie of them just standing on an island, just talking.
Pretending to like futz around with their packet or their bags. It's like, but okay, ready to go. And then we meet our pilot of the float plane they'll be taking to the illegal snorkeling destination.
Yes, Lindsay goes up to him and he's like, she's like, hi, Xavier. And then he just like enters this like void of depression and his face just becomes like this, like a sad clown's, like so dramatic. And he's like, my name's Javier.
Yeah.
But we don't get our subscribers by doing cooking shows, you know what I'm saying? Hector, come on, we got this, don't worry.
It's Javier.
Javier, right? Oh my god, I am so sorry. That was really terrible of me. I actually feel really bad.
A powerful character.
Javier is the character I relate to most because he just has manic depression. It's fine.
Javier is the pilot of the plane, which happens to be a JPEG that's sitting on the water 10 feet away from them.
So, like, I don't know. I brought this up while Aaron and I were watching it, but in some movies, the lower quality makes your effects look worse and makes them more noticeable. But honestly, in this, I feel like the 480p DVD actually like did it a favor in a weird way.
Yeah, it kind of comes off instead of like being a bad effect in the middle of something slightly defined. Instead comes off like a meme that's been posted to iFunny in like its 10th generation of being compressed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, no, because so, if you watch like Attack of the Clones on a DVD, it looks like 1,000 times worse than the Blu-ray or 4K versions. Well, like this, I don't know. I think those effects would only look worse. I think the compression just blends a little bit. I mean, still, of course, looks like a fucking JPEG, but it's covered up a little bit.
I guess we could mention the video quality. So, like I said, the disc advertises that this is in standard, you know, in-your-house widescreen 1.78 to 1, but instead this movie is actually in something a little bit thinner than that, so you have black bars going up and down either side of your screen, and the compression creates, like, this weird artifacting around those bars, which is something you don't see very often.
No, yeah, there's
it's like this weird banding effect that, like, it's honestly hard to describe. I've never seen
it. It's like, if you look closely, it's like pixelating and pulsing, like, on the edges. I've never seen, like, an official release with that.
Well, you know, I always try to make sure that there's motion going on in the visuals for our clips on YouTube. Check those out, audience! So, you know, maybe that was an intentional choice as, like, sort of like a, like, an iTunes visualizer when you're listening to Nickelback or whatever.
Yeah, I'm sure that was definitely their intention.
Yeah, that was the first thing the director thought of when he was putting this together. You know, the auteur behind it.
So they all pile into the airplane, and we have just another scene where we underline the tensions in this love triangle that's going on. And it's revealed that this high-end vlog channel only has one camera, and it's a GoPro mounted on to Evan's helmet, which he is using to record them, which I thought was funny.
Yeah, dude, like, even vloggers have, like, nicer mirrorless cameras or DSLRs, or, like, and also, like, multiple cameras.
We see him with that, but instead he decides to shoot a great portion of this vlog that is going to get them millions of hits, as
on
they
a
say.
GoPro, where he doesn't even pan around to look at the other people on the plane. He just, like, sits on one shot.
He doesn't treat it like he's a cameraman. Like, they make a big deal to make him and the other girl, like, the, like, they're the actual crew people who, like, deal with they're doing to an extent. But he just doesn't look at them. He acts like there's not a camera on his head, and, like, this footage is gonna be fucking unusable.
I will note that his other, like, his little DSLR that we see him with looks like the most basic, like, beginner, like, Canon Rebel that's, like, $300 or $400. Like, the cheapest DSLR possible. Which I thought was kind of funny.
Evan, we take all this time to roast you for, you know, having a camera and being weird, and then you do this? You gear shame the man?
You know what? He deserves to be gear shamed.
Oh, yeah, we can watch a big Evan versus Evan throwdown.
This airplane set that they're on is just... I've seen plenty of bad in-vehicle sets that have just been, like, slapped together for low-budget productions, but, like, wow, this really takes the fucking cake. Because they're just, like, in the set hull of the airplane, and outside is nothing but white. Like, they didn't green screen in clouds or anything.
Yeah, and there's 10 crew members, 5 on each side of the set, like, pushing it around to simulate the motion.
Yeah, because they get into an accident, and, you know, if you have a set like that, usually it's rigged to have, like, hydraulics that shake it around. But this extremely low-budget production, it seems like, at best, you had crew on the outside maybe moving it a little, but generally it's just the camera shaking a lot.
Yeah, it's mostly the camera shake. But can I ask, how did... How did the accident happen? Because I missed that. Because it seems like they're just flying, and then all of a sudden the pilot's like, there's something wrong, and then the next shot is like the half of the wing shearing off.
Yeah, as the back of the disc says, they get into the accident that like leads them on their adventure. But I have no idea. It's just they're talking about their dumb bullshit, and then all of a sudden it's like, we're going down, folks.
Yeah, brace for impact. Yeah. It's like, wait, what?
Yeah, and it's not just... It's like, oh, the entire, like, structure of the plane is just collapsing in and on itself. Like, someone opened a black hole in it, and...
Oh, you know what it is? I think it's Javier getting revenge for being called Xavier.
Oh, do you think... Yeah, Javier just sabotaged them.
Yeah, he went kamikaze to just dunk on these fucking vlog nerds.
In that moment when Lindsay called him the wrong name, he was like, well, I'm going to kill these people.
And myself in the process, potentially.
Yeah, you almost want them to be like, Javier, bring it in close. And he's like, oh, no, that's dangerous. And then they're like, no, we got to get it for the YouTube views. And then
we got to get the shot.
Yeah, and then that causes an accident. So then it's like kind of their fault. And then it's like, oh, well, they, you know, because they're kind of weird, vain dicks. But the movie doesn't actually seem like it thinks of them as that. It's very
no,
weird.
They're all Mary Sues.
Yeah.
None of them have any discernible character flaws other than being a sex pest, I suppose.
Yeah.
They're John Does and Mary Sues.
That's Javier's.
Javier displays like a character trait, so...
That he likes for people to pronounce his name
correctly. I think automatically
correctly.
He's a little
having
better.
Having manic depression. Yeah, I guess that is a character trait.
It's a pretty big one.
But this is the scene that introduces us to the tenor, timbre, and tone of the special effects of this movie, which are just stunning. I mean, Sci-Fi Channel originals are always a spectacle of bad effects, but wow, man. The plane is like the most cheap 3D model you could render, and I mean, it's a plane. It's not hard to put together something that smooth. And the ocean that they fly over, you can see where, like, the pattern of, like, the texture of the waves repeats as they're flying over it. So it looks like something that you would find on, like, Xbox Live Indie Arcade in 2008.
It's also kind of astonishing, because, like, sci-fi movies are normally, they're gimmick-based. They're like, look at the stupid garbage... tentacle shark cyborg, but this is just sharks. They're just fucking sharks,
and the name isn't called like badass crazy sharks or anything, and it instead has one of the worst names ever.
Yeah,
it's just a straight-laced survival movie with sharks.
Yeah, it's actually kind of jarring because it's such a straight-laced though terribly written movie, is that it's like the fucked up effects and constant appearances of the sharks where they look terrible is like surprising to me every time, because it feels like something where it would like not show it would be it feels like it would be one of those low budget movies that would barely show them, and it would be like, you know, they'd have like a prop and they'd like, you know, try to keep it to a minimum, but because it's a Sci-Fi Channel movie, it's constantly cutting to these shitty effects. It feels like it's from a different movie.
Yeah, the IMDb trivia here, like, it says the budget was shot... It was shot for under 500K, million, in 12 days.
What?
But yeah, so I think that all of that budget primarily just went to, you know, getting all the actors to Thailand, and they actually shot on open water, which is very expensive.
They did. However...
So the 500K is the shooting budget. It's the, is that what it says? That's how they actually, like, went
out
for?
IMDb trivia. Don't ask for much.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't... Enough. Yeah. It also says parts of the film had to be rewritten during the shooting process due to last-minute issues with locations, which only underlines how expensive those said locations must be.
While they do shoot in open ocean for a pretty decent amount of it, there are lots of, like, close-ups that are just clearly in a pool because they like they didn't account for the difference in like the waves, because like when it cuts a close up, it's like there's almost no waves whatsoever, and it's like, okay, that's a swimming pool.
Yeah, it's like placid water. Yeah. There's also like a fascinating continuity error where the plane crashes and then our lead character is in open water and it cuts out super wide. But then in the close-ups you see these like weird reflections and you're like, what's that? And then when it cuts back out, now there are suddenly a bunch of pieces of debris just on like every inch of the yeah. water around her.
No, that was really funny because we thought that there was just the reflections of like the crew members standing there, but turns out it was actually supposed to be there, but they just did a poor job because those debris were nowhere to be seen in any of the other like wide shots, like aerial shots of the ocean.
Yeah, so they're stitching together these really just disgusting CG wide shots of the ocean where it looks like an Xbox arcade game. And then we also have them in actual open water, which is very expensive, but then also like the cheapest pool that they could shoot in, because like whenever they are in the pool, it's like that's what all the underwater shots are in the pool. It's like that is not salt water. That is not what the ocean looks like. And when you can see like the outside, like around the pool, it's just white, similar to the plane. I don't know. I guess they think that the sky is just a white void, I guess.
It's just a skybox. In some of the deleted scenes, the characters just start T-posing and clipping through the plane.
T-posing into the shark.
The sharks come pretty close to, like, glitching and clipping through things.
Oh, dude, yeah. Like, I don't think, whenever we jokingly call bad effects JPEGs, but I don't think I can stress enough how much these actually look like JPEGs.
Yeah, these sharks in question, they start appearing almost immediately after they find themselves in the water. So,
yeah.
So Lindsay, Kaya, and Seb all land in close enough proximity to each other that they can assemble and find their bearings somewhat, and they also find Javier, who is dangling in a piece of debris, and he's like, so underwater, there's in the fin of the plane, there's a locator that you gotta turn on so people can find you, which I guess was turned off because they weren't supposed to be there, and then also the provisions that they're going to need. So they find the life raft and are able to inflate it. And so, you know, they're in a pretty good place, but Seb, being the low IQ bimbo, himbo that he is...
Yeah, in his infinite wisdom, he decides to swim out with on his own to try to get to the weird rock that's in the distance, because he thinks he can radio for help.
Yes, and this man who is an experienced diver has been established that that's like what they do on their channel or whatever. He is like, yeah, no, I'm going to swim through like 5 miles of open water to get to a sheer cliff, and that's going to save us all. I'll be right back. He's like, I'll be back soon, guys.
He keeps saying that. And then like Lindsay tries to go after him. And then just out of nowhere, he gets yanked underwater and chomped in just to pieces by sharks.
Okay.
Yeah, like 3 fins of sharks in like a line start beelining toward them. And they're like, oh, shit. And Sebastian's just like slowly swimming back to them.
I gotta say, we skipped the hilarious first shark kill where fucking Javier is on that piece of debris. And he just kind of falls asleep. The main character goes to go talk to the other characters. And a shark just snatches him, like, 2 feet behind them. And they don't notice.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That was like a comedy bit. Because they don't hear it or see it or anything.
Anything.
Just goes, yoink.
He just yoinks him right off the plank. It eats him right there, and they don't fucking notice anything's happening. It feels like if it's from a parody film.
It's supposed to be like a horror, almost like, not a jump scare, but like a, you know, like a little sting. Like, oh shit, there's sharks. They don't see them. Turn around.
Poor Javier, man. What a... He really got the so shit bad. End of this bargain.
He did.
He got called Xavier, entered in a manic depressive state, and then his precious plane crashed and he died within 2 minutes of landing.
Unless, of course, this was actually part of his master plan to kill them all and then himself, in which case he succeeded.
Well, he actually succeeded even harder because he died painlessly, or seemingly, because it seems like he just got insta-vored.
Yeah, that thing just sucked him right in.
He just doesn't exist.
I think you're underestimating Javier's pulling power in Frenzy 2, where he returns as the king of the sharks.
Yeah, he's like riding sharks underwater.
Yeah, it's like the Indiana Jones 4 scene where Shia LaBeouf swings with the monkeys.
My name is Javier!
And he's got a robot arm now. See, that's more of a sci-fi original film than this is. Something that actually has like a premise. Like, normally the problem with sci-fi original films is they have like a dorky, fucking stupid premise to hook you, but then they don't have the budget to like do anything with it besides flash their like awful model of the monster sometimes. But this one, it's just a generic low-budget shark film, but the effects are hilarious and disconnected from the shots.
Yeah, this is where that, like, whole thing really kicks in, and it just becomes, we're in the water and my friends die every so often. From here on, it's literally just like, oh, we gotta survive, and the sharks appear. Very conveniently, they appear whenever anyone slightly leaves a raft or anything.
So, there's only the four of them that they find initially. So what is it? It's like Evan and
the sister fly the fuck
Paige?
Out of the
yeah
Paige.
Sister.
They get sucked out of missing. The plane.
Oh yeah, they literally get sucked out of the plane, which was also very funny to look at.
Yeah, so we just have Lindsay and Kaya now
because Javier and Sebastian died. Immediately.
Yeah. After they're dead, Kaya delves into her hilarious 15-minute backstory monologue about how you gotta live and, like, you know, you gotta fight to the end and carry, you know, a piece of the others with you and stuff. Her monologue is so...
Yeah, while she's, like, holding her dog tags.
Yeah.
Because I guess she was in the Iraq War.
Sometimes you just end up a creek on the way out. That was on borrowed time anyway.
And it's so fucking, like, cliche and weird, and she, like, keeps specifically stating the hardware, like...
So the next morning, AC-130 swoops in. She tears the place to pieces.
And started shooting its 50 cal rounds into my friends, and... Like, it felt like she was doing, like, the joke was going to reveal that she was talking about, like, that was a Call of Duty multiplayer match she participated in.
Yeah.
I feel like usually with monologues like that, that shows you what the writer actually wanted to write. Because I wouldn't be super interested in writing a shark survival movie, but writing this overwrought monologue would perk my ears off.
Mm.
But while all the other characters are dispatched with little care, Kaya's not one to escape this treatment because after she delivers this hilarious monologue, she's immediately killed for, like, little reason other than she's not Lindsay.
Yeah, I honestly forget how she even dies. I mean, she obviously gets eaten, but I forget how it happened.
I think she's just scooped off of the raft that they're on.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
so she's just around to deliver this monologue and put a lot of emphasis on these dog tags that she's like...
Private Clark was bleeding out. He knew he was done. He was scared. We all were. So he grabbed my hand and he put something in it. And it was his dog tags. So I hold on to this. It helps me remember that no matter what happens, life goes on.
And that the dog tags never appear again. It's not like Lindsay was able to retain them in her death or anything. Exit screen left.
She gets yanked off stage with one of those hooks, except it's by a shark.
Oh yeah, they're done. This jobber character, I'm sorry that we wasted your time with them. Dead. Goodbye. Not to be mentioned again. It's actually, like, interesting how much the characters who aren't Lindsay, her sister, and Zeb are, like, acknowledged after they pass. They just evaporate because they're not part of a weird, vague love triangle.
They take all this time to establish these characters in a way that you would expect them to, like, offer things to their survival. Like, you know, war veteran knows tactics and... Evan's the tech guy, so he knows how to operate things, but no, they're all just fucking dead. Yeah. Even Sebastian, because you said, like, in proximity to the love triangle, they might receive preference, but he's the first character to die, too, so...
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. He actually
first main, second overall.
No, you're right, because that actually calls to a problem in the movie, because it's, like, so much of its emotional heart is built around this, like, vague tension, but he dies 10 seconds in. So it's like, I don't know why I'm supposed to care anymore. Dude already's done. He ate shit immediately.
Well, okay, and we should mention the framing device that this has, which is while these events are happening, while they're being stranded in the ocean fighting for their lives against sharks, it keeps cutting back to Lindsay's perspective of when she first joined the vlogging group.
The lit life.
And so it frequently cuts back to that, which is, I will say, is a trope in survival movies. 127 Hours does that, and I don't know, Adrift, I think, does that. Lots of them do that. And it's just kind of a way to be like, we slowly learn more and more about how they got in this situation and what their characters are like, you know, and it can be done well, but it's not here.
Because every time it flashes back, and these flashbacks happen at complete random intervals, it's just like whenever there's a downbeat, flashback time, we just got to get a flashback in here. But every single flashback is just underlining what we already know from the opening scenes.
Yeah. It doesn't add anything about their characters. It's just like, yeah, okay. I think we assumed this.
Let's think about this from, like, what the ideal version of this story is. Just even taking the elements, as shitty as they may be, what would a good story from this be? It would be, you know, all the characters, their traits play into... the survival, like I said. And so they all have something to do before they die, which endears you to the characters and makes you feel something when they die.
Exactly. I really like survival movies. Big fan. Because I like to see sort of what you're talking about here. It's like the ingenuity and like little gadgets and things you could make out of nothing to help you. Like, I like that kind of stuff. But this has like none of that. And if it is, it doesn't make any sense at all.
They just have a character that's like, here are the things that you need, here's how you get them, and then they just do it. There's no sort of DIY element to what they're doing. And I think the other element of like the good version of this would be, like, while they're stranded in the water, like, they're talking in vague terms about the drama that's going on between them, and then maybe the flashbacks through time kind of reveal what they're talking about, because they're kind of talking in insider terminology. But yeah, none of that happens. Just, you know, everything right off the bat.
It's all like laid out for you. And so it's like, why even bother with the flashbacks?
It's pure filler content. It's just, okay, we need scenes that are not expensive. And, you know, we can't film everything. It's fucking...
We'll shoot it at this resort.
Yeah, we'll shoot it in this two-star South American shithole, and we'll fucking have these characters just fucking ramble their generic plot points at each other. Let Evan be a loser no one likes. Let the sister be bitchy and, like, full of herself. Have Sebastian be vaguely muscular. And the other woman to say nothing and sit in the background. And it should...
Oh, she afraid of scuba diving.
Yeah, she afraid of scuba diving, though. The closest thing it gets to, like, trying to create irony out of the flashbacks is when the main girl's like...
I've always dreamed about diving with the sharks somewhere in the Great Barrier Reef.
And then later in the movie, not close to that flashback, like in a weird, completely disparate point, she ends up in a plane... in the plane, and it has holes in it, and the sharks are swinging around it, so it's kind of like that, but it's so separate that I feel like that wasn't even an intentional connection.
Yeah, that may have just been a coincidence. But yeah, so at this point Lindsay's just completely alone in the raft.
Previously, Javier, one of the things that he mentioned is like, oh, there's a raft inside of like the various like land masses outside of the island.
Supplies.
Supplies? Where? In what cove?
At this point, it's just Lindsay alone in the water because all the characters got jobbed out immediately. And she has to get to the raft, which is by the landmass that Sebastian was trying to swim to. And first, right. Like Aaron said, she's underwater. She dives down, turns on the locator. Really not that big of an issue. We get to see the underwater tank that they shot in its full glory. And they very clearly just shot the stuff on those sequences with a GoPro because it looks way shittier than the rest of it.
I said the same thing when we were watching it.
Well, that's like the cheapest, waterproof camera you can get your hands on.
Exactly. So it's like, why not shoot it with that? But yeah, it looks the quality is notably worse, and it's pretty easy to pick up on. She grabs something out of a box too, in addition to turning the locator on, and then she swims back up, narrowly escaping the sharks.
The box has like a pop latch on. It has like a latch you would like pop to open it, but she doesn't fuck with that at all. She like shoves like a knife or something into the box that forces the corner open and then reaches in.
Like it's a treasure chest or something.
Yeah,
but there was no lock on the like the latch. You just had to lift up the latch.
So not only does she not know how to do diving or island exploring or vlogging,
she doesn't know how to open a box.
And I said, like, oh, yeah, she goes down and gets it, no problem. But, yeah, like Evan said, she's, like, narrowly escaping the sharks. But the way that the device of the sharks is used in this movie is so lame. Because it's just, like, whenever someone's not on a raft and they're in the water, sharks appear and start swimming toward them. And that just becomes so repetitive that the danger lurking in the water is just null.
The way this movie depicts shark behavior is a little too unrealistic because they are just always there. Every second they're in the water. And it's like good shark movies like Jaws or whatever will use the shark sparingly and in a way that could actually be conceivable and like align with what they might actually do, which is like, okay, I come here for food. I eat a person. I leave for a while. But then I learn slowly over time that I can come back here for food. It's not, oh, I ate a person and now I live here now. You know? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, they're always there. And when you're making a movie that's only thing is that there are sharks, yeah, you might want to think about, like, how sharks work or possibly even how they look. Because, like, the box says, these are great white sharks. You know, big motherfucking sharks that will swallow you in one gulp, but right. Between shots, just even in like a sequence where sharks are constantly in it. They are just popping between scale just constantly. Yeah. There's no sort of consistency to it. And most of the time, they're usually like a quarter the size of a great white.
The shark behavior is also reminiscent of a video game. Because, like, okay, in a super poorly programmed video game, like one that's just made out of stock assets and thrown on Steam as trash, the AI, the enemy AI, it will only be programmed to, are you near me? Or did you cross point? Go at you. Directly towards you. In a straight line. And that is how the sharks behave at all times. If you touch the water, shark go towards you in straight line. Instantly. From wherever it is. And if and then, as shown later, if you get on a raft and you aren't leaning any limbs off of it, if you cross that threshold, you're fucked. But if you have no limbs off, the shark will jump out to bite you and then will be repelled by the fact that you are on the raft and will turn in midair to not bite you because you are in the safe zone.
Yeah, the sharks have, like, they have no hops whatsoever. Much like white men, they can't jump. They can only get, like, their snout up on any sort of surface that they're floating on. Yeah, so it's just, like, if your limb is sticking out to its full extent over, maybe they'll come after you. But otherwise, they'll leave you alone, even though they could rip that raft in half, as they seem to have the know-how, knowledge, and want to do.
Clearly the NPC sharks are top tier creatures, villains.
Yeah, the NPC sharks do a great job fucking up our NPC protagonists.
Great whites don't travel in packs, as far as I'm aware. They're very, like, solitary creatures.
Lone wolves,
I don't know. Again, that's like a nitpick that doesn't really matter.
It's not a nitpick, because, like I said, the only threat in this movie is sharks.
Well, yeah, that's true. No, you're right. They should have put more thought into the driving antagonistic force.
I think the point Evan's just trying to make is it doesn't have to actually be realistic. Like, when you watch Crawl...
No, yeah.
Crawl's a great movie with, alligators fucking with the people in Florida. And alligators are not that fucking aggressive, but they don't behave realistically.
But they explain it in a way.
And they both give you...
They give a reason.
A somewhat reasonable reason. And two, while they are not, like, the most realistic alligators in the world, they're pretty fucking big, and they're just, like, super aggressive. They don't just spend every waking second trying to murder the main characters. They kind of go around a little bit, and if they think they can get at you because you kind of swung in near them, they'll make a bite at you. They don't just make a beeline the second you have left your raft or whatever, the moment you touch pavement. There's more verisimilitude to it, even though it's not super realistic.
Yeah, I think the bottom line is, like, you don't have to be completely realistic, but maybe don't be so unrealistic that it's, like, distracting.
Yeah, and it's also one of the missing character beats where you just have, like, the nerd character, in this case, the Evan character, you have him know, like, too much about sharks or something, and then he can explain it. So yeah, there has to be a logic to it, but this movie has literally zero logic, just shark scary pretty much it.
Well, and as we see, as the movie continues, is she tries to kill the fuckers like she could just get rid of them, but the movie just has a million sharks. Like, it means nothing to kill one of them.
Yeah, rendering that completely useless. It's not a single shark movie, it's a...
infinite sharks?
Question mark sharks?
Respawning NPC shark film?
They really do behave like NPCs in a video game. They're just infinite amounts of them. It doesn't matter. Like, they'll just come after you no matter what. It's something.
Yeah, so Lindsay, with very little to mention prior, makes her way to the raft. She gets there, and the box is there. And then another's just one more jab at Javier, poor Javier. She opens the box and she's like, damn, that crazy motherfucker wasn't lying. It's like, why would he lie to you about emergency provisions?
They treat Javier like dog shit, like that they're scraping off of their shoes.
He's credited on IMDb not as Javier, but as Island Pilot.
Oh my god. Even whoever made the credits dabbed on him.
It's all around just sad. It's a sad story, but this is where his story ends, because he's never brought up again, and neither is anyone else. Because Lindsay is on the raft, and now she gets a flare. And here's something interesting, where in a survival movie, when someone gets this flare, it becomes a strategy. It becomes this, you know, a last... This is what is going to get them saved. I have to make sure I don't use all of these flares up.
I need to sit and wait for a plane to come by or for me to see some semblance of people.
But she doesn't do that.
Fires it immediately. And it's like, okay, cool. You just wasted your... That's awesome. Good job.
She gets the flare in her hand. She takes the pistol and shoots it in the air with no sort of sign of anyone... anywhere close, and there goes a flare. And it's determined earlier, before that, that the other flare that's in the pack does not work. So that is, in theory, the last flare she could possibly utilize.
And it was for nothing. But wait, was it? Because her sister appears from behind the rock and is like, hey, I saw your flare.
And She's like 20 feet away. It's like this comedic reveal where it shows like a wide shot of just both of them in the frame. And Paige is literally like 10 feet away from the raft.
Yeah.
This whole time.
She's just kind of drifting on this, you know, whatever piece of wreckage from the plane. And she's like, where'd you come from? Like, what? And Paige is like, yeah, I was around the other side of the cove and I saw your flare and I let the tide carry me. And also my leg is broken. So it's like, okay, wait. So the tide just happened to be going in the same direction as you saw the flare. Because you can't self-propel yourself because your leg is fucked up. So I was like, okay...
Yeah.
And this is like the 55-minute mark where they like rejoin and she finally has someone to talk to and whatever. I don't know about you, but this is where I was like, oh my god, there's 30 minutes of this movie left.
Yes, I wanted to talk about this. This was some dumb bullshit movie. It was like, whatever. I you know, it was bad. It was kind of funny sometimes. And I was just like, moving with it, fine. But once they came to the static location where I knew the moment they got there that they were going to spend the rest of the movie there, I, like, wanted to leave the room. I was just like, oh, no. They are just going to talk on this fucking raft. And I partially knew it because her sister's leg's fucked, so they're not going anywhere. So it's just going to be 20 minutes of them deliberating, sitting on this fucking thing. And we're going to... Until they get saved or whatever. And I just... Like, my heart sank, man. It was like, oh, this is going to be the worst.
Yeah, it's like that moment you realize that you're... When you're watching a run around in the woods movie.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. The moment where the production value drops.
Where they go into the woods and then they spend the rest of the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you're watching a cheap sci-fi film and you're like... Oh, this is fun. I like what they're doing with this stuff. And then they step outside of the fucking woods. And then after they spend a couple minutes, you go, oh, this is the rest of the fucking movie.
Oh, no. Yeah.
They finally rejoin on this raft. And it's the static location. But we very quickly are alerted to what their new goal is. Because out of nowhere, a boat shows up like... 100 yards away from them, and the guy's like yelling, and somehow they can hear him, but he's like, I'm gonna save you now. I'm going to save you and call the Coast Guard now. This is what I am going to do.
Hello. This scene is so funny. So like, they're pulling up, right? And his like second mate or whatever has a harpoon gun, and I guess they're they're aware of the fact that sharks are in the water. So the guy goes to bend over the side of the boat with his harpoon gun to get a shot at one of the sharks, supposedly. And then he just topples over comedically into the water and gets eaten.
It takes like 5 seconds where he pulls out the harpoon and... The two protagonists, in an extremely unlikable move, they're like, what are they doing? They're not saving us immediately? What's happening?
Why are they looking for them? Why aren't they coming to help us?
Hey! Come on,
get
us!
The sharks! Hello! What are they doing?
And then, the first mate just takes a nosedive off.
Right, and he's getting, like... eaten alive by sharks, but he's still trying to cling on, and he's like, the captain rushes over and tries to reach his hand out, and then a shark jumps out of the water and shears his hand off.
Yeah, and then he stands around on the top with his arm missing for a couple seconds, and then comedically just prat falls into the fucking water. It's
he tumbles backwards into the water,
and they both just fucking die. They get just torn the fuck apart in what feels like a dark comedy sequence. Like, it's so inappropriate, and I don't think it was going for humor. So it's just...
No, it was not. I just wonder, are there any worse jobbers in, the history of
cinema?
Movies?
I don't know.
Than British poacher and his first mate.
Yeah.
They're so stupid.
Yeah. If the goal is to save them, why does he even bother to try to shoot a random fucking shark? Like, what is he attempting to do? Because he does it instantly.
And if the goal is to not save them and just poach these sharks, which is what I think it's going for, why did they even mention that they were going to save them?
Yeah,
what was that about? Were they just, fucking with them? I don't understand.
Yeah.
This part is just absolutely
because they wrote an end to the movie and then realized that the movie needed 10 more pages of script to be feature length. And they were like, okay, the guys who save them have to just fucking die. So
they get eaten alive, and then that leaves the boat just drifting there for them. So that's now that's their new goal.
She spent all this time making it to the raft only to need to go right back out to where she was almost exactly.
Those guys are oblivion NPCs. Stand up, something comes near them and they aggro, and they're just they go stiff, and they're like, oh, you should never have come here. Try to attack them.
I'm afraid your journey ends here, traveler.
So now the rules have changed, and our NPC characters have a new compulsion.
Get to the fucking boat is what they want. And this is the point where they, for some reason, decide that the only way that they're ever going to be able to do this is to kill every single shark, one by one, with Home Alone-esque... machines.
Yeah. But they make one machine somehow, where they lasso this styrofoam cartoon rock that's on the cliff face.
Yeah, they look up and there's this rock, and it's like, oh, that rock's loose. And it's just plastered, super glued on styrofoam that they lightly painted to look kind of like the rock.
It's the fakest looking rock I've ever seen.
And then they fucking they draw a shark to them. Using their blood or whatever.
Yeah, it's they lure the shark in, applying the rules of what they've learned that these weird non-shark acting sharks do, where they only appear if you're dangling over the side, which is like a video game. Yeah. They're using the rules. So they start flapping their arms over the side of the raft to draw in these sharks so they can then drop a rock on top of their skull.
And they perfectly time it. They perfectly time pulling the rock and it falling on the great white as it jumps out of the water, killing it instantly. But then they go, oh, well, where's the next styrofoam rock so we can repeat this? And
they have the audacity to say... Wait, let's do that again.
Yeah, how the fuck are you just gonna keep spawn camping these NPC sharks with these rocks? And like,
yeah, well, the rocks will keep spawning.
Oh.
They're like, we gotta find another loose rock. It's like, what?
Dude, it was like the biggest stretch in the world the first time you did it. What are you talking about?
And then they look around, she looks up, and they do not do a shot of the cliff face, they just do a shot of her looking up, and she immediately goes, I don't think there are any more loose rocks, I give up.
But they don't have to think much longer because, like, pretty much out of nowhere, a page, like, ends up dangling her leg over the side and a shark bites it. And she just has, like, a shark bite on her leg. It's, like, the one prosthetic they did in the movie.
Well, no.
There's blood pumping out
of it. It's her sister, Lindsay, goes in the water, and then the shark beelines to her, and then Paige, jumps in front of her to take the bullet of the shark, and gets bit.
Right. And then she tries to stab the shark, which she does, but then... And I think she kills one, but then another one just comes around and bites her leg.
Yeah, and she gets her leg bit, and, like, this is the point where, like, the character has been shot in the lung and is slowly, the air is releasing from them and they can't live anymore. But she just got bit on the fucking leg, and she's giving, like, her deathbed confessionals to her sister, and this is the big emotional moment. I mean, it just feels so shitty because it's, like, it's just a fucking, it's literally a flesh wound.
I mean, to be fair, shark bites go deep. That could be... pretty detrimental.
No, this is true.
But you're right. It's not as dramatic.
It's also the fact that she's like, oh, I'll stop the bleeding. And she's like, no, it's too deep. But the wound is not actively bleeding. Like, at least to us, the viewer, in movies, if it's a death wound, you have to be like that isn't super visible on the outside. You have to show that by showing the, like, arterial blood pulse that shows that, oh, like, this got her on the fucking artery, a main fucking vein or whatever. She's going to bleed the fuck out. But she's barely bleeding, and then she just kind of, like, lays there and takes it. It's like, what are you doing?
And she says, no, I'm good. I'm done.
Yeah, she's like, no, I can stem the bleeding. And she's like, no, look here, here's the screenplay. I'm not on the next page.
She just, like, she decides this is where I die, and then seconds later she's just dead.
Yeah,
she's gone.
Yeah,
it's over
after their dramatic talk where she reveals importantly the resolution to all the weird sexual tension bullshit from earlier in the movie is that she was jealous. They've both been jealous of each other their whole lives, apparently, which is why Lindsay came on this stupid fucking death trip. Is because it's like, oh, I gotta prove that I'm cool to my cool sis. And then we learn that on the other end, her sis is like, oh, my Lindsay's so perfect. Everybody loves her. I'm like the dumb bitchy one. No one likes me. So she decides that she's going to fuck her sister's boyfriend to get power over her and show that she's superior to her. And goes through with doing this, but as we find out, Sebastian, who died 8 hours ago in the movie, who you no longer remember, chose not to cheat on his girlfriend, and was thus a great and perfect man.
Yeah, that's like the big flashback reveal is like, oh, they didn't actually, there's no actual cheating going on or anything, but that just makes it all the less anything. It's such a wet fart of a conclusion to the human arc of these characters, what little there
was.
It's
the only story this movie has, besides, like, Escape Shark. And it resolves in, oh, actually, the thing that you were worried about, it was nothing.
Is that the name of the video game that the movie actually is? Escape Shark?
I mean, it's probably what the working title was.
Yeah.
So at this point, Lindsay once again is alone, and thus comes the end of the sisters that kind of look like Blake Lively, which has no relation to the fact that this is a mockbuster of The Shallows.
And little connection that I thought was funny is that the lead actress, faux Blake Lively, her name is Reynolds. Like, her last name was Reynolds. And Blake Lively is buried to Ryan Reynolds.
How deep does it go? Lindsay's alone. It's time. We gotta get to the boat. The clock's ticking. The movie's about to end. Let's get it over with. So she's like, okay, I gotta go to the boat. How does she do that?
Dude, I think she literally just cuts and swims to it.
And yeah.
At which point I was like, why the fuck didn't you do that sooner? And then she could have got to the boat, started it up, went back and picked up her sister, and then they would have cruised into the sunset.
Home free.
It's like, I could be wrong. I'm pretty sure it's like she distracts them somehow, like something stupid. And then
I don't think she even distracts them. I think the shark
she kills
just
one.
Eats her sister, and then she goes, fuck it, jump.
No, okay, so she kills one. Remember, she like she harpoons one. And then, like, then it's, like, tangled. So she ties the rope to the platform, and so that renders the shark, like, immobile. And then she, like, has that gasoline, and she pours the gasoline over the shark, and then she, throws a flare at it or something?
Yeah, she shoots the flare that has been established as to not work whatsoever.
Yeah, wait a minute.
She takes the flare that we've determined earlier in the script is completely worthless, and she just pops it in the gun, like, not even hesitating, like, no, this is gonna work, and just shoots it at the gasoline that she's dumped into the water.
Yeah, and then the shark lights on fire and is, like, burned alive. It's like, okay, so, what are you gonna do about those other sharks?
Well, yeah, for some reason at this point she determines, oh, there's only one shark left, which, you know, never has been a definitive number of how many sharks there are, but she's like, that's the last one left.
I think the number might actually be three.
They said, like, at least three, but they never determined the number officially. Like, they were never like, okay, there are three.
And it never... Okay, yeah, and it never comes across as if it's the same three, because they just come out of nowhere from all directions, like, at all times.
Well, and so it's the same shot of the fins approaching them that they use every single time.
But also, those sharks take damage, and that they, you know, at no point retain the damage visually. Like one of them gets their eye cut, right, and it slashed. And
well, Aaron, how do you expect them to do that when they use stock footage?
And they'd have to render an eye that's hurt and have the shark express something.
Yeah, between the stock footage and between actually having to render the models, like, come on.
Yeah, no, but it's like in a real movie, one of the ways, a common way to be like, oh, there's only three sharks, and these are, like, connected throughout the film, or is to be like, oh, well, when the girl slashes this one in the face, it's now going to cut across its eye, and now you know it's that shark. And then it's like, oh, okay, yeah, this one got burnt, so it's got burns all over it or whatever. That's that shark. But they retain no damage. So it just, they come off like respawning NPCs.
Well, they didn't characterize the humans, so why do you think that they would try to characterize the sharks, you know?
This is a great question.
Yeah.
But yeah, in this kerfuffle where she's killing this second-to-last shark, for some reason, one of the sharks finally decides that, oh, I can get up on a raft to get to this food that I'm so voraciously trying to get at, and eats her dead sister, which just upsets her so greatly. And it's like, your sister's already dead. Just let the shark eat. Yeah, maybe they'll leave,
like,
you alone.
She's like, no, let her go.
Well, she also, when she finds Evan's corpse earlier and that gets eaten, she spazzes about that too and holds his head and screams, I won't let you take him, as they instantly take him. And right, and before she records her flashback fucking framing whatever video where she goes, I love you, mom and dad.
I want to mention, since you brought up the flashbacks, a lot of the flashbacks, there's this really weird thing trying to connect the present and the flashback where, like, a shot from the previous scene will show up screen. And it's so strange. Like, for one instance, like, there's a shot, the same shot of the three sharks swimming, they show, like, 50 times. Like, that appears on Sebastian's laptop in their sex bed, or Evan's, like... oh, smells like sex in here. And it's just so awkward and not fully committed to in a way that it means anything. And it just, you know, that like, oh, the filmmakers were like, oh, here's something that would be visually striking, but it's executed so poorly that there's no benefit
to
it.
On the first mm-hmm. one that happens is that the movie, you know, they crash the plane or whatever, and then it cuts to her like waking up. And she's like, oh, I just had a weird, scary dream. And for a second, it's like, did she just wake up from the movie? Like, did any of that happen? And then you learn that
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah, first...
Yeah, we thought it was a fake out and that none of it happened, but then turns out it's just the awful framing device.
Yeah, it was going to be like, oh, you know, they crashed and are surrounded by sharks, and that was a nightmare she had before they went on the adventure, and then it happens for real in the next scene, but no, it's just weird nothing.
Yeah. Incredibly weird nothing, like every single one of the past scenes in the movie.
Right. All the characters, all the scenes, weird nothings. Frenzy, a weird nothing.
You put that on the
put
box.
It on the box.
Yeah. When you re-release this in 4K, you can slap that on the box.
So Lindsay says fuck it, makes a run to the boat. I'm just gonna cut and get out clean. There's only one shark. There's no danger in one shark, she thinks, I guess. And she swims to the boat with like almost no sort of struggle. She swims over, she gets on it. And this is the point where you're like, okay, she's home free. She's on the boat. All she has to do is fucking
drive
the boat away.
Yes.
But no.
Dude, unless I missed it, for no reason, completely unexplained, she just like can't drive it or like won't. From what I could tell, it was just like, why would the keys not still be in the ignition? But they never address it. She seems to just jump on there and then start like gearing up to try to kill the last shark. But it's like, just drive away.
Go, just leave. Yeah, no, she's very intent on killing this last shark as some sort of half-assed attempt at revenge or something, instead of just cutting loose and, you know, heading to the island that's merely miles away.
Yeah.
So she just struggles, and of course the shark starts like fucking ramming the boat. So she just makes she gets no benefit of actually getting to the point that she's been trying to get to this whole movie.
Right. The shark at one point jumps up and like half of his body is on the boat and he like wriggles around and he like dislodges the outboard motor of the boat. And then it's like, well, you fucked up. There goes your chance of driving away. Good job.
It's just like, here's the point in the script where we need a climax. We need a big confrontation to go on here. That's so stupid because, you know, we've established that she's home free. I guess the thought is like, okay, after the shark destroys the motor, she can still contact people. But that's pretty weak. That's a pretty weak sort of ending point to put the movie in at the, you know, the 80-minute mark or whatever. So this is where the movie just decides that it's Jaws. This is just going to be Jaws now.
It importantly cuts to a flashback where her sister goes, I once saw a oxygen container blast off and fly around and almost kill someone.
Right.
Convenient that she would say that in the past, you might say.
So, yeah, light bulb goes off in Lindsay's head. She grabs the tank. She grabs, like, a monkey wrench. And she's, like, positioning it, trying to aim it. She's holding the wrench, gearing up, getting ready to, like, smack the intake valve or whatever on the tank so it'll fly. And it's like, bro, you can't aim that thing. Come on. But, so she waits.
She doesn't use the fact that the sharks will bite anything that is dangling over, as you might like in Jaws, and lodge it in its mouth.
Well, but Dylan, but then it would be exactly like Jaws. It's gotta be a little different, you know.
That's fair. Yeah, no, because instead she fixes a knife to the oxygen tank and aims it at the shark. And then says something very close to along the lines of,
"Smile, you son of a bitch!
Come on, you piece of..."
Yeah. and launches it at the shark. And where you might just think it like, oh, it smacks the shark in the head and it dies. It flies into the shark's mouth and goes out the other side of its skull. Like, yeah. Just a Mortal Kombat fatality.
I don't think you needed the knife. I think that, yeah. That was actually kind of like, I mean, again, the effects are awful, but if that looked even vaguely okay, it would have been pretty cool.
I have breaking internet shark news. Shark great whites travel in groups called in schools and stuff. They actually do that. However, okay. They don't NPC dive at anything at any time. All that, those elements.
Yeah, I think that was one of the criticisms of Jaws, was that, like, you know, they travel in packs. One of the, you know, because Jaws is a great movie. It's a classic for various reasons, but Bruce, the shark of that movie, does not at all act like a shark, and that's not a problem in that movie, because it doesn't make you think about it too much, because of the way that it appears, and, like, it only shows up occasionally. It's a properly utilized plot device.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not in, like, it doesn't have that much screen time.
And that's why Jaws is effective.
Yeah, because it builds tension.
When you think of, like, pacing a movie and just, like, limiting the appearance of the monster of it and everything, generally that is the reference point that you go to, is Jaws. So the fact that they weren't able to pick that up from Jaws is astounding.
Like, that's the reason why I thought, you know, in my head, I guess media does trick you about things, is that great whites are more solitary, because I've seen 50 great white movies where they are, and like The Shallows. So it was just like, oh, yep, there's a shark, yeah. And it's fucking with me. And I have to go from the Shallows is somehow even smaller scale than this, but it, like, has, like, tension.
That's crazy.
And, like, the snakes, the stakes make sense. There's no snakes, unfortunately. And
they, I hate snakes. Thank God. Yeah. Maybe I'll watch it.
Yeah.
I need a content warning on my movies, whether there are snakes in them or not.
Yeah, well, because, and that film's made by, I can't even fucking name, but the schlock auteur that made The Commuter, so it like, has, like, weird Hitchcockian tension and, like, dumb shit, and it's filled with, like, cartoonishness that's kind of fun, that's, more...
I would probably like that.
More so than, this, where the cartoonishness is just, like, what the fuck is happening?
To wrap it up, that is the end of the movie proper, really. There's no, like, explanation as to how she gets out of it.
Well, no, but she kills the shark, and then she turns around, and then there's, like, 50 boats coming towards her. It's like, oh. Okay. The movie's, like, never about, like, getting out of the situation. It's just about killing the sharks. And it's like, can it be both? I don't know.
Yeah, they do not make, like, actual attempts to escape. And there is visible land masses pretty close. And, like, it's never even, like...
Like, within swimming distance.
Yeah, it could be a good, like, a harsh swim, but it's, like, a swim.
Well, yeah, but you could do it.
But they don't even bring it up as an option. Like, that's the thing, is, like, if they decided through conversation or something that it wasn't, like, the right move, it'd be something, but they don't even talk about it. It's, they just act like we're in the middle of fucking nowhere and all we can do is stab these sharks to death, or have a person randomly come to this shark reserve that you can't enter legally and help us, which are both insane. Well, both ways out are insane.
Or lasso styrofoam rocks and make them fall on top of their heads.
Yeah, they do think they're going to beat the sharks to death with a variety of loose boulders.
So after all this commotion, we are done with the movie proper, and Lindsay, then we see her on a beach, which is very clearly the same exact beach that the rest of the movie was shot near. It's like the same rock formations that she's been struggling on this whole time, which I guess you know, she returned to relive trauma, because that's what everyone wants to do. And she sets up a camera and records a follow-up vlog to the death of every member of the vlog family.
Hi, everyone. I know it's been a while since our last post. 6 months, actually. But you all heard the stories by now. You all know what happened. I wanted you all to know that the people who made this channel, they cared about you. Thanks for watching. I'm Lindsay Lewis, and this is The Lit Life.
Dude, could you imagine, like, tuning into your, like, favorite vlog channel and finding out that they all died tragically? And
yeah.
But getting eaten by sharks. Yeah,
the Paul house got nuked.
Yeah, yeah. Though when you, you know, when you find out that the crew from Fun House went on, like, a fishing trip and were ripped apart by fucking sea monsters, it's like, how do you fucking convey that to an audience? Has that happened? Like, has there? Because I feel like there has to have been some group of influencers who all just fucking died. At least, maybe not English speaking ones.
I'm aware of.
Yeah, I feel like we'd know about it if something like that happened.
Yeah.
She's like, okay, lit fam. I know it's been 6 months since there's been anything hitting this channel. I just wanted to wrap up and let you all know that we all loved each other and we were best friends. And
but unfortunately,
it's sad.
I'm the only one left.
And I have no know-how for vlogging, and I'm not very interesting, so that's... Yeah.
In fact, I'm canceling the channel.
You guys liked me because you thought my weird relationship with one of the people in the group was hashtag life goals, but now I'm going to be the entire channel. And at which point, the whole subscriber base leaves.
Imagine, like, just tuning out of a YouTube channel, as one does, for, like, a few years... And you don't hear anything about it, and then you just look back later, and, I mean, it's often that you find that, like, they stop uploading. But then you find that the last upload is like, oh yeah, everyone died.
Yeah, it's,
like, the two best friends, like, the last video uploaded.
They died.
Oh yeah, they violently died because someone broke into their home and, like, slaughtered them O.J. Simpson style.
Yeah, like, oh yeah, I used to watch these guys. I wonder what they've been up to. Oh.
Evan, I'm sure that's going to happen with one of your fishing vloggers. I feel like that's
main
the
place
ideal
for
type
happen.
Of person for that sort of event
actually,
to happen.
Actually, yeah. Especially, and couldn't, like, relate it to this movie.
There's just something...
They died horribly on a fishing trip.
There's just something magical about it conceptually. I think every YouTube channel should, host a mass suicide or participate in a suicidal event to bring your channel to a close.
I think the last few months should be like, they're meeting these new people that seem kind of weird, and then slowly over, like, their daily uploads, it's revealed that they're in, like, a Jonestown situation.
I think it's happening to Brad Jones.
The cult of Doug.
I gotta remind the audience, these people die because they try to do, like, an illegal psychotic thing for no reason for view counts. I think if they leaned into it and actually made them worse people, I'd feel more sympathetic to it. But they're just nothing, so I gotta go, lol, okay, idiots, good job.
Yeah, but that's the end of the movie. Any other further thoughts on the movie, I guess?
Why does it always have to be sharks?
That's a good point, Evan. That's a very good point. Why do you always have to pick the most unbearable movies?
Yeah.
You should be put on probation, Evan.
I don't think it was unbearable. I thought it had funny... Like, it was... I don't know. I don't think that was...
The back 25 were kind of rough, but, you know, there was some pretty funny shit in there.
Yeah, but we'll get to that on our final decisions on the movie. But so the video quality, we already talked about it, really. It's just horrendous. It is just, like, one step above the Mexican movie 4-pack that we've watched.
Yeah.
And we established that's, like, the lowest quality we've ever seen on a disc, so that's not saying much for this.
That will never happen again. We will never see something with lower quality than...
Los Dos Reyes.
Los Dos Reyes.
Yeah, well, we found our second place. We found our second place here today.
This is a stern second place contender that honestly would be hard to beat in and of itself.
The aspect ratio is fucked. There's weird pixelation banning shit on the sides. It's a just generally ugly rip. Someone has a YouTube upload that's cleaner.
Yeah, you can find this actually like in high definition because someone ripped the Blu-ray and it's on YouTube illegally for free.
Yeah, and
so
this movie is like so... No one cares about it, so no one bothered to take it down. Meaning the DVD has negative value.
Yeah, that upload is from February 2019, which is like when this movie came out. It has been sitting up there. no one has tried to remove it from the internet.
Well, you kind of touched on this, Evan, and I think we don't need to go around the table on this when we examine whether this is a bargain or not. This is that part of the show, folks. I think we can all just collectively say, yeah, it's not a bargain just because of many of the reasons we've listed.
Because, like, I'm pretty sure the general consensus about the about Barney's Great Adventure on our last episode was that it has negative value. So do we have a new category called a negative bargain? Because I think Frenzy and Barney can join it.
At least Barney had bonus features. This, like we said, no trailers, which, I mean, whether you think that's a bonus to anything or not is up to you, but nothing beyond the menu and the, two English tracks of surround and stereo.
Yeah.
It doesn't even seem like there is closed captioning on this release.
Yeah. Insane. So, I think this is a, I don't know, nega bargain? Anti-bargain?
There's not even like a sub-menu on the menu that like lets you pick like your audio options or anything. You gotta hit the audio button on your device, which I don't know if most people understand the function of.
Dude,
so this is...
It's like I ripped this and made this DVD in the menu screen and I dumped it in the bin.
Yeah, this is on the level of like a $5 movie that like you shot in high school that you want to give copies to your friends.
In fact, the Blu-rays that I'm currently making for my college short film, I think, are going to be a million times better than this.
Wow, bargain maker, Evan.
Yeah, that's I'm going to distribute them. I'm going to put them in bargain bins for people to find. I think that's...
If you contacted the right person at Echo Bridge Entertainment, you might...
Yeah.
You might be able to just get worldwide distribution of your 20-minute film.
Exactly. But yeah, no, I'm just astonished at the pure, like, laziness that was involved when making this DVD.
Yeah, it's cynical. Definitely that's the word for it. But this is the part where we now decide whether or not we recommend the movie itself contained on the disc, and if we don't, we have a substitution to give you as recommendation. So, Aaron, do you recommend Frenzy/Surrounded 2018?
No. The movie is terrible. It looks like shit. Like, I don't just mean the rip or whatever. It's like a shitty-looking movie. I don't like any of the characters or feel anything positive about any of them besides Javier because he tried to kill them all. And, it's just junky and bad. And the thing is, I'm not even trying to compare this really to, like, real movies. Like you'd be better off watching Sharknado, like, legitimately. And I'm going to make that my recommendation. It's a stupid fucking sci-fi channel movie. It's bad, but it's, like, it knows what it is. It's watchable. And it has better effects than this. It also has, like, humor. And I can identify the characters.
Yeah.
So it's just a much higher effort production, also from Asylum/Sci-Fi Channel. So I'd recommend that. I'd recommend a lot of like sci-fi original content above this. I wish it had a gimmick. Like something to it to at least have like a place of interest, but it's just a shark movie, but cheaper and uglier. and without like proper structure to it. So there's just not a lot. There's nothing to this to where I could ever recommend it to somebody.
I also don't recommend this movie for all the reasons Aaron said, plus more. It hits points where it almost feels like it could be a so bad it's good, like the weird sex creep stuff.
Oh yeah,
some of the action is just so absurd and weird looking.
It's close, but it never.
Officially strikes it. It's not really worth 85 minutes of your time for like the what, like 1 minute of like stuff that you might enjoy in it. So definitely don't recommend it. And in its place, I will be recommending a excellent survival movie set on the seas, starring Robert Redford, directed by J.C. Shandor. All is Lost. What a great movie. It's just one guy who is finding himself in the situation that his yacht is like damaged beyond repair, and he's stuck in the middle of the ocean with no way to communicate with anyone. It's a very unique movie in that there's almost no dialogue in it, and what there is mostly just curse words said by Robert Redford to himself. It's great. There's this just wonderful scene like leading into the third act that I just like. I hold that in very high regard as like one of the best movie scenes I've ever seen. It's like the calm before the storm. It's excellent. It's such a good movie. It's on streaming occasionally, and I could not recommend it enough. It's one of my favorite movies of the past 10 years. So that leads us to Disc Purchaser, Bin Puller,
the only perspective
Evan,
that matters.
Vlog do you enthusiast. Recommend it?
Vlog.
And weird sex pervert.
Yeah, he's a Team Tenor for life, you know?
Right.
What's an official member of Team 1000?
So I don't recommend this movie. And I have a soft spot for survival movies, as I think I may have previously mentioned. I'm a big fan. Like even like lame ones or just ones that the vast majority of people consider to be bad, I can almost like give like a little bit of a pass, or at least like see the good qualities in them. I've just always liked them. Like, I don't know, 127 Hours is great. Even like I saw a Drift in theaters that has like awful romance elements, but it's still much better than this. And it also has the same framing device.
You were tricked into watching A Mountain Between Us, or The Mountain Between Us, or whatever it is.
I was. And while you guys hated that, I strongly disliked it, but at least had a few bits. I don't know. But I was tricked into watching that. It just turned into a flat-out romance movie, which was really lame.
And creepy.
Yeah. But yeah, even as a lover of survival movies, I can't pull any redeeming qualities. As Dylan said, it almost hits that point of being so bad it's good. So, but yeah, you can't. It's not worth it in the end. So in its place, I would like to recommend Crawl, which I think Aaron mentioned before. It's just absolutely awesome horror movie. It's produced by Sam Raimi. It's directed by
Alexandre Aja.
Yeah, don't know. Whatever. Sorry, man. Sorry for that, but don't know how to pronounce
cool
it.
Dude.
You seem pretty cool. but yeah, it's just like the thing that strikes me about it is like it never lets up. The pacing is really great. There's a lot of good set pieces. And it's not like an amazing movie. It just kind of hits all those beats that you want it to. The alligators, while like a little, you know, exaggerated in terms of how aggressive they are, they at least like explain it.
It's believable.
And it's like it has enough of a logic that you are able to buy into it, at least for me. But yeah, it's just really cool. It has a lot of awesome moments. It's pretty much, it's this movie, but you replace the sharks with alligators, and you make it good. So,
well, there you go. Two good movies and Sharknado to replace your watching of Frenzy. Well, that just about does it for this episode. You can find us on all your favorite podcatchers, Stitcher, Spotify, Apple, all at bargainbingepod.com, and I highly encourage you to check out our YouTube while you're there, because I put a bunch of clips on YouTube to relive your favorite moments, and I think they're pretty cool. I've been refreshing myself on After Effects. I always try to make it a little bit visually interesting, even though it's just audio clips. So please give us the clicks, give us the likes. I think you'll enjoy it. They're all in 4K for no reason. For no reason, but they're all in 4K, 60 FPS.
Why not?
So enjoy it. My computer hates me for it.
Yeah. Steal your neighbor's internet so you can watch it in its full quality.
Also on bargainbingepod.com, you can find links to our various merchandise. We have a link to the Teespring, where there are t-shirts with jokes from the show and just the podcast art. You can also find that just directly at shop.bargainbingepod.com. And then you can find a link to our stickers, where you can buy them directly from us. They're 3-inch by 3-inch circle stickers with the podcast art. And they're only $5 shipped, and that's an excellent deal. So get on that, please. You can email us. Please email us. We haven't gotten any fucking emails. We want to respond to something.
Yeah, where you at, guys?
Tell us if you like the show, hate the show, whatever.
Hey, timestamp bots, stop it. Stop it right now.
Yeah, the only interaction we've had in our career as podcasters with anyone on the internet is bots on YouTube, and I'd really like for anyone out there to end
it. Well,
we
got one comment, please. That I deleted it. So please post something and don't delete it.
Yeah. Hey, dude,
hey,
why'd you do
Ohio
that?
Ohio guy.
We liked your comment, right?
Guy from Columbus, Ohio. What are you...
Mansfield.
Or whatever.
Mansfield,
what are you doing?
Ohio? Yeah, we were excited.
Whatever.
Maybe he was he was a little shy. I don't know.
You know what? That's exactly like an Ohioan. You know what? Yeah. Why should I expect any more from that fucking dreadful state? Yeah. Get better, motherfuckers. You can't just ride off of being worse Pennsylvania for the rest of your fucking existence. Get out of the Union if you're not gonna get any better. Like, Jesus Christ.
Thanks, Ohio.
On that note...
Annex Ohio. Hashtag Annex Ohio.
And all of our Ohioan listeners and beyond can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Bargain Binge Pod. So yeah, the bonus episode next week is going to be... Space Jam 2, A New Legacy. That's right, we've learned that we can record episodes and edit them faster so they don't release months after a movie has lost its relevancy. So check that out. I'm sure that movie is going to be dog shit when that comes out in 2 months from this recording date. That should be fun.
We're desperate for internet clout and that the juice that's given when you put up a video for something that came out recently. Thanks, fans.
Yes, reward us. Reward us for her good behavior. But until next week, I have been Dylan.
I've been Aaron. God damn it. Step over me one more fucking time.
What do you mean?
Sick of this fucking shit.
Dude, I fuck it. Bruh, come on, man. No, don't.
Maybe we shouldn't have compared him to the sex pest.
No, don't fucking hurt me, Evan, please. Oh, no.
Oh, no, he traversed the 10 feet over to Aaron's room, and now they're both dead, much like we were talking about earlier. This is the last episode of Bargain Binge, maybe, I guess. Okay, goodbye, folks.
I'm gonna fucking kill you. Ah!
I feel like we're off our game today, fellas.
You think?
There's some funk. Bad juju. What's up?
This one wasn't exactly like super like the we kind of jumped around a lot, but I don't know.
Yeah,
I feel like there was some decent bits.
It's a weird thing. It's an ephemeral concept, podcasting, you know.
Yeah.
Potting with the best of them. SEOing with the worst of them.